Happy to be here. So today I'm going to talk about DBT. It's a new technology that I'm very enthusiastic about and would like to share that with you. So it's called democratizing your pipelines, because if you use DBT, your pipelines become much simpler to build and to maintain. I think John mentioned that we worked at ING. I think DBT would be like a perfect addition to the stack that we used back then, but it was not around at that time, unfortunately. So a bit about me. I think John mentioned the most of it. So this is me skiing last year, no skiing this year, unfortunately. So I have a background in distributed systems and software engineering at the University of Groningen. I'm a code connoisseur, so go data driven. You can think of your own title. So this is what you get then. I'm a big open source enthusiast. So I'm a member at Apache Software Foundation, the big non-profit organization that governs a lot of the open source projects. I'm a committer in PMC on Avro, Druid and Airflow. And a committer on Parquet. So if there are any bugs in there, I'm sorry. This is my email address. So if you have any questions, please drop me a line. So the obligatory slide about Go Data Driven. We're an Amsterdam-based consultancy company. We're doing mostly data engineering and data science. Also involved in data strategy. And now we're also doing analytics engineering. So this is a new upcoming role that's also very involved with, for example, stuff like DBT, building analytics pipelines in the cloud using modern day software. About around 50 consultants used to do a lot of Hadoop. Now everything is shifting to the cloud. And if you want to work, just drop me a line again. So let's get to the core. So let's talk about DBT. It's a short for a data build tool. And it's very important that you spell it lowercase, because that's how it's spelled. Otherwise, you get a lot of critique on the online. So as you all know, building data pipelines, it's quite hard, right? So you start with a data lake, you start ingesting stuff, you're with a big team, and you have to coordinate stuff. It's very easy to turn this data lake into a data swamp. You want to get started and you want to build stuff quickly. You have stakeholders wanting to have access to the data. You forget stuff like data governance, data lineage, data ownership. That's super important. It's also a requirement nowadays, so you cannot even skip it. But it's easy to go over this. I think DBT is a nice tool that helps you implement a lot of these things. It applies structure to your data. I always tell it it's like an implementation of data ops. And data ops, it's maybe a new tool or term, but it's like a derivative of the DevOps that we know from software engineering. And I think a lot of these concepts from the software engineering that we see in DevOps, you can also implement it in when you're developing your data pipelines. So you have this cycle here where you make incremental changes. You apply tests, you build it continuously. You deploy your data pipeline a couple of times a day, and this is all captured in data ops. So how we see this at DBT, and I will come back to this later on. So the code is all SQL. You have the build step, which you do with DBT compile. You have the test step, which you do with DBT test, to make sure that you're up to standard with your data quality. Release is going through Git, and deployment is just Docker. So no weird UI, it's all code. And to run it, you just do a DBT run from your command line or from your CI/CD or from your Airflow orchestration or whatever you're using, your Azure Data Factory, if you will. So what is DBT? So DBT is part of what they call the modern data stack. This is a quite interesting movement going online. It's about what they call the modern data stack is like using a lot of stuff off the shelf. We used to build like a lot of stuff on our own because it was not around. For example, if you want to ingest data, you would write some fancy Spark program. But nowadays you see like that you have a lot of tooling around, like for example, Fivetran. If you want to have your data from your Google Analytics into your BigQuery, you can write this yourself. It will take you a couple of months, maybe a couple of weeks if you're fast. And then you have everything in there. and then you forgot the column, you have to go back. So this modern data stack focuses really on having like more off-the-shelf kind of tooling that will help you to hit the ground running. DBT is a tool for compiling and running data pipelines. So it's actually a combination of a compiler and a runner, and we'll go into more depth later on. And it's a simple tool to build complex pipelines. DBT itself is quite simple. I think that's the powerful part of it. So often you're in a very complex environment. If you look at ING, there's a lot of terminology. You have a lot of, if you look at the data sets, there's a lot of context, a lot of organizational knowledge built into this data sets and also the data pipelines. And that is where the complexity is. So if you also have like a complex tool, then you have complex times complex, and it's going to be like maintainable. So I think one of the powers of DBT is like, because it's so simple, it allows you to have to operate in a more complex environment. It takes the best practices from software engineering. So if you're a software engineer, you will definitely like DBT, and you can do stuff like linting and do your classical pull request, have testing not on your code but on your data, and the dry principle of don't repeat yourself, so you don't have to rewrite the code all the time. So it's also quite opinionated. One of the things is that it's SQL only, and I was a bit afraid in the beginning, but we used this at several clients, and from practice I can tell that most data pipelines you can just express in SQL as well. Why is this so important? So this is how I see it. This is not based on any scientific evidence, but this is my perception of my consultancy life. You have the very tech-savvy Scala developers, but you only have a few of them. And they're extremely smart and write Scala all day. On the other hand, you have like the SQL developers. Like the most business analysts nowadays can maybe write some SQL or maybe use at least some low-code kind of tooling to do their data analysis. And actually, like I said, a lot of the organizational knowledge that's inside of the data sets, and you don't want to transfer this all to the Scala of Python developers that write your pipelines, but you actually want to push it down so that also the people that do the day-to-day business with the data sets, that are also able to encode this knowledge into the data pipelines. Also, when you look at from a more computer science perspective, Scala and Python like imperative languages. So if you write Python, you write what you're doing, and with SQL, it's a declarative language. So it also, you can write, with imperative, how you do it, and with SQL, it's like what you do. So you select star, then it's much different than with Python. Because it's declarative, it's much easier to also analyze. So you know how the pipelines runs, which data sets you're using. So it's much easier also to do static analysis on that. And that's very interesting, I find personally. So DBT on the hood. So DBT, it emerges actually from the data warehousing side. So it has first-class citizen support for Postgres, Redshift, Snowflake, and BigQuery. So it's also mostly cloud-based. It's created by Fishtown Analytics. It's a Philadelphia-based company. They raised like $30 million in the A series and 30 in the B series. So it's got a lot of funding. I think that's also it shows the interest in the tool, also by investors. It's a huge open source community. So if you have any questions about DBT, you just go to the Slack, and within a couple of minutes, you have a response. It's a very active community, which is very nice. It's distributed on the Apache 2.0 open source license. So if you want to relabel it and want to sell it, you can do it. It's just Apache 2. And it has a lot of second class citizen support. One of them is, for example, Spark/Databricks. So Databricks is the managed Spark. It also has support, for example, for Athena or for SQL Server or for, so everything that talks SQL, there's probably like a DBT plugin for. And the nice thing that I find, like I'm a developer, with Postgres, Redshift, Snowflake, and BigQuery, everything works out of the box. With Spark and Databricks, you sometimes have to do some open source activity just to fix some of the nitty-gritty bugs. So how does DBT fit into the stack? So this is like a schematical overview. On the left-hand side, we have like the data loaders. And these are the, like I mentioned, like FiveTrain or Stitch. They are like a SaaS software to load data from all kinds of sources. It can also be some kind of Airflow job that takes the data from your ING mainframe, or maybe schedule some jobs through the OCR that we saw earlier today. And then it will dump all the data into the raw data that we see on the left-hand side. And what's important here, once it's in the data warehouse, it should be like structured data. And so from when we take the example from earlier today with the OCR, and you go in with the PDF, which is like unstructured data. And what will come out of this data loader is then like a Parquet file with a couple of columns that describes this PDF. And then we go into DBT and we end up with transform data, which can be like a source for your BI tooling, but also for the input for your models. And you can also do like feature generation, this kind of stuff all in DBT. So it features the standard data warehouse that support it, but also Hive and Apache Spark. And Hive is there because you don't do any Hive SQL, but you use the Hive Metastore for the managed tables. So how does this look like? On the left-hand side, we have the base. So these are the tables created by the data loaders because you don't see anything in front of it. So these are the tables that are being unloaded onto the data lake using your data loaders. And then you can have like a pipeline where you refine the data. So this is the base. Then you combine these two into staging app orders, staging Shopify orders. You can join these, probably union these two into all orders. And then on the right-hand side, you have the fact orders. That's coming from all orders and staging customers. Yeah, so this fact orders is the fact orders.sql. So this is what they call a model. And when you do select some fields, say from, and this is like, if you are a Python developer, you will probably recognize this. That is a Jinja templating where you say ref all orders, which this file as orders, and then left join ref staging customers here. So this is how you express your transformations in DBT. So it's all SQL and you use the ref to point to other models. So why is this so powerful? Like I mentioned, DBT is like a compiler. So when you run the thing, if you do DBT run, it will fill in it will compile the SQL and fill in the actual table and database names. So let's consider a very simple a pipeline that we here have, like staging beers. We convert this into a fact breweries, into fact styles, beer styles like IPA or bit beer or whatever you like. So, and this is also the lineage graph that comes from DBT itself. So it has like built-in documentation. If you do generate docs generate, you will, you do doc serve, it will start like a local browser, but you can also do like docs generate and host this in with Nginx or put it into a bucket somewhere. So everyone in the organization can see the whole data catalog. And this is how you express it in SQL. And then you see like, hey, if you do DBT in it, you will just get this structure. And with the models where you can say, okay, we have this fact breweries, which is this one. That does like an aggregation, takes a brewery and does some average, compute some averages group by brewery from staging beers. So this ref, when you run it and you look into the compiled directory, and you can actually see that it will be filled in on compile time. So in this case, it's very easy to make like, for example, like a staging environment and a production environment. And this makes it very easy to have like different environments. So if you're working on the data pipeline that you're not messing with the production data, it's all, and you don't have to do weird stuff with your Airflow, but you can just get it all of this out of the box. What we often do And when we have like a nice CI/CD pipeline, and we just inject like the branch name in there. So yeah, if you have a team with 10 people, and you don't never have to wait on your colleagues because they're working on staging or whatever. So if you then do dbt run, it will actually execute the whole pipeline. If you see here, we have like three models. It will start with the first one, the staging bears. Here it will start it, run. It's finished in 1.27 seconds. And then it will run the second two in parallel. So there's also the notion of parallelization here. If you run everything into a notebook or whatever, that's often a bit more difficult. But dbt just, it resolves the graph so it knows which jobs it can run in parallel. And this will be run in your Spark backend. And if you, for example, use Databricks, then if you go to your staging database, you will see the tables there. So what I personally find very powerful about dbt is the annotation of the models. So we have the schema.yaml. So there's a YAML file that you put into the same directory as your models. You can give it a name. In this case, staging bears. It's equal to the SQL file name. You can give it a nice description. You can give the columns here, like bear, the name of the bear. So you build like this organizational knowledge of the data. What does this column mean? You encode it into the pipeline itself. So often you see this this being put onto some kind of Confluence page that's always out of sync with the code. And here you just, yeah, you put it next to the actual transformations, so it never gets out of sync. So we have a couple of more columns. Then we have the state, and here you can say, okay, for example, we have a test here with accepted values, and if there's a state that's not in these values, it will give an error when you run dbt test. So in this case, we say the beer, so there's one of the columns say not null, and it should be unique. Can the beer name be unique? So if you run dbt test, it will run all the tests also in parallel because there's no dependency on each other. And it will tell you that unique beer name. And this test, it failed. There are 82 violations. And it will tell you where the SQL is. So you can easily rerun the SQL and find out which ones failed. So this sounds very trivial, but it's actually quite powerful. So if you work in a team and everyone is changing the pipeline, then you can have some constraints on the data just to make sure that everything keeps sane. So typical tests that you can execute are not null, uniqueness, accepted values that you just saw, but also referential constraints. So if you have, for example, an order that has a reference to a customer, and this customer doesn't exist, then it can throw an error. And these are the typical things that you see in a data warehouse, but are not available in a data lake. Data freshness. So if you say, we should expect this table being updated every day, you can assign a column that has like a date in there. Say, okay, this should not be older than 2 days, for example. And you can say custom test. So if you have some, if you want to compare some columns, maybe add some orders and compare it to something else. And like I mentioned, it will, when the test fails, it will tell you which test it was. It will tell you and which test failed. So you can just copy this, put it inside your notebook, and just run the SQL, and then you can see that these are duplicate. So probably, there's more than one in there. It's of course perfectly possible that the beer name is not unique. I would like to stress that this is all code. So if you change something, you have just have to go through a pull request. Typically with these kind of tooling, you see that it's like some kind of GUI or no pull request kind of stuff that you can do. I think it's super important because if you change the definitions of your columns, then you should also notify your colleagues, right? If you change something in the pipeline, then you should discuss this with your colleagues. And I think pull requests is a very nice way to do this asynchronously. So you don't have to have a meeting all the time, for example. But yeah, so I really like this. So the moment that we've been waiting for, some live coding. So this is just the code that we had. So let's for example just add like a new model in there. Let's call it factory beers. So I live in Haarlem, and the GoDaddy-driven office is in Amsterdam. And with these Corona times, I often go by car. But you cannot drink too much, of course, and shouldn't. You should even not drink at all when you're driving. But yeah, I just want to know like which beers are safe, just to drink one, if I have to go by car. So we go to the staging beers, and we know like the APF. It's like the alcohol percentage, and we know how big the beer is, so we can actually check like how much alcohol is in there. So maybe this is a nice thing just to write for now. So we do a select with let's just do a select star. Oh, what's this macro? Then we say ounces. Yeah, I'm not from the UK, so I'm not really comfortable with ounces. Say ref, staging beers, right? Let's make a small macro, say rosette to milliliter. But this is like the dry principle where you don't repeat yourself. We say, rosette to milliliter. Column. Name, macro, and you say there's all the Jinja templating that I discussed earlier. So this is just like a Python, well-known Python library. What is it like? 573.5.296-ish. And now we have like, if you have any models where we do this transformation, we can reuse it. And we can say like okay. We say like Ninja templating again. Milliliters. Good. Nice comment table expression. Star from I think this is something like this, like two beers. So depending on like how big the beer is times the alcohol percentage, I'm still allowed to drive. Right? So you go to the schema.yaml, say, because I think I'm of the belief that YAML is not meant for humans. Say the name of the, I don't want to take any risk here. Let's say like test to be not null, because we should always know this, right? Otherwise you should not drink, maybe not drink at all. And then we can do dbt run. Now it found four models, so we have like a new model. Make it a bit bigger. So now we see that everything ran. So we go to our Databricks environment. And we can see that we have the new column. So we have the volume in ounces and the milliliters. It's like I can. And we can say DBD test. Now it will execute all the tests again. Oh. So now we see there's the uniqueness, one that failed, and 62, one of them are not null. So I actually know that the ABV, this one, it's sometimes null. So we don't know how much alcohol is in the can. So in this case, I would say, okay, maybe we have to go back here. So we say coalesce, right? If you don't know, let me say false. If you don't know the alcohol percentage, then we say false. If you rerun the pipeline and we rerun the tests, then it should pass. I think that is like an illustration of the iterative way that you run these models. So you write some pipelines, you add some tests to it, and then everything should pass. And if not, then you should fix it. So you actually keep control of your pipeline. And I want to stress once more, like, if you write your pipeline by yourself, then it's very easy to keep everything inside of your head. But if you're especially working with bigger teams, everyone is changing the pipelines, then you want to have some tests in there just to make sure that everything still works as expected. And you would say, like, git diff, like, check, everything looks good. Then I can assign a colleague to it just to review it. So, small recap. So, you write all your code in SQL. What's still being executed by, for example, Spark or your favorite cloud or on-premise data warehouse. I personally really like SQL. I think it's super powerful. If you cannot express in SQL, maybe you can fix it with UDFs. Otherwise, it becomes a bit troublesome. You run dbt compile to check if everything works. Dbt test to check if your data still data constraints still hold. You do your release and deploy using Docker and Git. And you just operate it using dbt run. So you can run it locally just for development, but also in your nightly run, for example, you can run it from your Airflow instance or whatever. That's it from my side. Hope you've enjoyed the talk.
Well, Foco, for once, I'm very thirsty now. So let's see if there's not too many questions so we can get to the beer. But there are some questions already. The first one was from Robert Morlijn. He asked, AWS, Google, and Microsoft all provide cloud tools for like supported by the same provider. Would they not include capabilities like this going forward in their tooling, this being open source?
Good question. Yeah, I think it's more than just running SQL. Eh? So it's not only in BigQuery, you can also do something similar. But having these DAGs and also developing like in this iterative way, I know that Google just recently bought like a company that does like similar to this, but I think it's not widely available yet, and it's fully open source, so you don't have to pay for it. You can just run it in your local CI/CD. You can easily Dockerize it, so it's very complementary to the existing stuff that's already in the cloud.
Thanks. Another one from Joost Blom. Nice talk. Is it only for batch processes or also streaming use cases? And how does it compare to Apache Beam or the GCP service data flow?
Good question. Yeah, so it's batch focused. So there are some stuff that that I did not cover. For example, you also have the incremental imports where you can do like like an hourly run, but it's all batch based. Yeah, so you can do micro batching, for example, and let's say you run something actually every 5 minutes. It's also very, you can have it's fully supported to incremental runs, but it's just batch based. Yes.
Okay.
So it compares to data flows like that. You also have the batch layer in there, where you can also do incremental stuff. So it's a bit complementary, I would say. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. I don't see any additional questions. Ahmed really liked your talk. I also spoke to Daniel just now. He also mentioned that this would have been a great tool when back in our days developing the product that we used to do. So at least you have a few fans here. Another happy people there in the crowd. So thanks very much, Foco. And I guess you're already at home, so you can drink any of the beers.
Exactly. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Foco.